بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. Dear respected viewers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another brand new episode of the program entitled Towards the Origin, watched live on the Channel S and onto the new channel now, which is Sky 777. To all of those who have joined us just now through our social media platform, that is through Facebook or website, we welcome you to this program. And inshallah, you can also watch this program later on our YouTube channel. And the following day, there will be a repeat as well at 11 in the morning. Our tonight's discussion is on the topic dealing with doubtful matters. In the world that we live in the part of the world that we live in, especially within the Western society, it's difficult and sometimes challenging for us to distinguish between what is halal or what is lawful and what is prohibited. And between them, there could be doubtful matters. How do we avoid them? How do we distinguish between them? And how can we keep ourselves and our family safe from doubtful matters? When I say doubtful matter, it is not only restricted to products or the food that we consume, but in every matter and aspect of our life, including the conversation we have, the gossips we have, the interaction with other human beings, all of this and many more, inshallah, we'll try and discuss and touch upon the Islamic principle of avoiding and dealing with doubtful matters. In any event, the formalities must be proceeded with. We've been joined by a regular guest who is the respected Imam, or one of the Imam and Khateeb of London Central Mosque and Islamic Cultural Centre, famously known as Regent's Park Mosque. We have with us Fadilat Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Welcome back to your own show after a long break, especially.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. It's a pleasure.
Jazakallah khair. In fact, it's our first episode since Ramadan, so a late Eid Mubarak to you, we can start with.
Barakallah feek, and same to you as well.
Jazakallah khair.
To all our viewers, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair. Now, let's start our conversation. Doubtful matters. Now, some may say, well, everything is doubtful. The world that we live in, the time that we live in, I mean, it's very difficult for someone to assess, analyze, and be 100% sure whether it be mu'amalat, whether it be foods, whether it be transactions, that it could lead to doubtful matters. So how should one be careful? But in other words, let's start and begin with, what does doubtful matter mean in the first place?
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wal'aqibatu lil-muttaqeen. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ثم ما بعد. After praising Allah and sending salam and salutations to the noble Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah. He is one and he has no partners. And I also testify that the noble messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the final prophet and slave of Allah, the Almighty. We are slaves of Allah. We are the creation of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our creator. He's our khaliq. He's our sustainer. He's our Rabb and he is our khaliq. So he created us and he knows what is good for us and what is bad for us. And so therefore, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala not only just created us, but also he made laws for us. He made rules and regulations for us. He made things that are allowed for us, and he made things that are prohibited for us. Allah pak rabbul alameen, amader srishti korta. Uni amaderke srishti korechen. Ebong uni amader jonno ayin kanun toiri korechen. Ebong Allah pak rabbul alameen, uni bhalo janen je amader jonno kunti uttom, kun jinishti uttom, ebong kun jinishti kharap ba khotikor. Allah pak rabbul alameen, he is the lawmaker. He makes laws. He is the muhallil. He is the one who says what is halal. And he is the muharrim. He is the one who says what is haram. And also, he is sahib al-tashri'. He is the musharri', the lawmaker. Uni ayn pronoun koren. Uni aynir. Allah pak rabbul alameen, amadir shabdurna ayne uni source, shutro. So Allah pak rabbul alameen, he make things halal and he make things haram. But when he made things halal and haram, he also made certain things that are in between, doubtful matters in between halal and haram.
Why is it?
And so we are discussing today in this episode, like we're discussing those doubtful matters. Maybe this will make, just before we go to that, I would like to also mention that just the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made the laws, we as human beings, we cannot make halal what Allah made haram. So meaning we as believers, we have no authority, we have no right to make things halal which Allah made haram. And at the same time, we are not allowed to make things haram which Allah made halal.
Now, you've touched a very valid point there, and I would like to pick up an important point from the conversation that you just had. When it comes to the matter of mubah, which perhaps not directly mentioned haram or doesn't contradict with the sharia, and it's not directly mentioned halal. So it may fall under the category of mubah, which is optional. You can explain to our viewers what it means. So then some may take a position of extreme saying, no, this is haram. And they don't even give dalil. Now, what is the criteria or evidence or the source for one to say this is haram? How do we make
that? Mubah is obviously, first of all, permissible. What is jaiz? We say jaiz. Just allowed. And to say something haram in Islam, we have to have clear-cut evidence from Quran al-Kareem, which is the first source of evidence in the Sharia in Islam. And then also we have to have clear-cut evidence, or we have to have clear-cut evidence from ahadith and nabawiyyah, authentic ahadith of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Until we have those evidences, we cannot say like things haram just because we doubt or just because we think or we assume this is haram, we cannot say it's haram. So again, just the way we cannot say things that are things halal and Allah didn't make it halal, it's quite, you know, it's not good. Similarly, we can't say things haram and Allah did not make haram.
Now, you can do the shomashot say, manushir, understanding and what they. There's a difference, first of all, mu'amalat and ibadat.
Yes.
এখন আপনার কাছে যদি কেউ যদি প্রশ্ন করে ইবাদাত যে আমাকে বলা হয়েছে নামাজ চার ওয়াক্ত পড়তে হবে জোহর আমি যদি তিন ওয়াক্ত পড়ি
Again, so this is again, we are changing the system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we're not allowed to do that, of course. We're not allowed to do. And we cannot make, we cannot change the laws that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala made.
তার মানে হচ্ছে ইবাদাতের ক্ষেত্রে যা কিছু বলা আছে দ্যাটস হোয়াট উই হ্যাভ টু ফলো
এক্স্যাক্টলি
এনিথিং আউটসাইড দ্যাট
ইয়েস ইয়েস ইটস কলড তাওকিফ মিনিং ইবাদাত তাওকিফিয়া মিনিং উই হ্যাভ টু স্টিক উইথ হোয়াট দ্য কমান্ডমেন্টস হোয়াট দ্য ইনস্ট্রাকশন সেজ
ওকে
উই ক্যানট গো বিয়ন্ড ওর উই ক্যানট গো ডু আদারওয়াইজ
আউটসাইড সো হোয়াটএভার ইজ মেনশনড দ্যাটস উই হ্যাভ টু ফলো ইফ ফজর ইজ টু রাকাত ফরদ এন্ড দ্যাটস ইট
উই ডোন্ট ডিবেট দ্যাট উই ক্যান্ট সে ওকে জাস্ট বিকজ আই ওয়ান্ট টু বিকাম আ বেটার বিলিভার সো আই ওয়ান্ট টু ডু 3 রাকাতস
We can't do that. Now, flip side, mu'amalat, whatever is mentioned directly haram, we know it's directly haram. But what is not directly mentioned and it doesn't go against the sharia, what's the rule on that?
Mubah, like, so if the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sakata anha, he remained quiet and silent about certain things. He said in another hadith, he said, like, I made things halal and I made things haram, but also I remained silent in about certain things. So do not ask about them. Meaning, like, if you ask, then, you know, Allah can probably make the laws for you to say, you know, don't do or do. But he just remained silent. And these are called mubah. So anyway, coming back to this discussion, I would like to mention a hadith of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to the doubtful matters. Now, this hadith is narrated by Nu'man ibn Bashir radiyallahu anhuma. Great companion Nu'man ibn Bashir radiyallahu anhuma narrates that he says, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ That I've heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Amir Rasul Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kashtaka shunta parachi, يقول, when he bolachin, he said, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّن That verily halal is clear. Or that mane obosshoi halal jinish gulo khubi porishkar ebong clear. Inal halal abayin.
Ekhane je halal clear bola hocche ekhon kichu manusher amader understanding hocche halal mane khawar khetrei.
Na
consumption of
food. Not only just food.
That's it.
We're talking about everything that we do in our life. So for example, even like dealing in transaction, even like as you said muamalat and even muasharat, public relation.
Okay.
So he said, like, you know, like certain things, like, for example, interest is haram, gambling is haram, for example, you know, drinking alcohol is haram according to Sharia al-Islamiyah. So So he made things haram, and they are clear. But then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentions, وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ. Between them two, there are doubtful things. لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. Many people do not know. অর্থাৎ ওই সন্দেহ সন্দেহাতীত যে জিনিসগুলো রয়ে গেছে হালাল এবং হারামের মধ্যখানে, অনেক লোক কিন্তু জানে না এগুলো। এগুলো শুধু এক্সপার্ট যারা আছে শরীয়ত সম্পর্কে, যারা পারদর্শী আছে, ওদের নলেজের মধ্যে, জ্ঞানের মধ্যে এটা আছে
না। এখানে একটি প্রশ্ন আমি করতে চাচ্ছি, কারণ এটা নিয়ে আমাদের কমিউনিটিতে এবং আমাদের সোসাইটিতে, স্পেশালি মুসলিম সমাজ, মুসলমান সমাজের মধ্যে এটা নিয়ে এত অনেক কনফিউশন সৃষ্টি হয়। হালাল এবং হারাম এই ফতোয়াটা কে দিতে পারবে?
আচ্ছা, তো অবশ্য প্রথমত আল্লাহ পাক রব্বুল আলামিন উনি কোরআন এবং হাদিসের মধ্যে ওইগুলো বলে ফেলছেন, কিন্তু ওইটাকে বুঝতে হলে জাস্ট টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড ক্লিয়ারলি উই নিড অ্যাগেইন এক্সপার্টিস, উই নিড পিপল হু আর কোয়ালিফাইড, অ্যান্ড obviously namely those who have done the courses of fatwa, not only just the basic fundamental courses of alim course, or maybe like graduation like kulliya or takharruj, but also those who went further and studied the fatwa and the adab of fatwa and how to deal with the fatwa, and again obviously in general expert in fiqh and other Islamic sciences. So again, dealing with the issues of halal and haram is like a barrister or like a lawyer. You know, he is talking about the law,
and Islamic jurisprudence.
Yeah, and a layman is talking about law. There's a huge difference. So someone who hasn't studied the law properly, obviously he is not a person of authority when speaking.
Let's make it simpler. For example, if a person who's a qualified doctor can only prescribe medicine.
Exactly.
A person who's a qualified in the field of law can give legal advices.
Absolutely.
Similarly, right. A person who is qualified in the matter of deen, fiqh, and Islamic jurisprudence, is it correct that
exactly.
he or she is the only person to have an authority to give a verdict on issues that revolve around Quran and Sunnah?
Exactly, that's right. And unfortunately today you can see like people who are doing, you know, on social media, there are so many people are pretending to be muftis, scholars, and maybe like some sort of Islamic authority. And there's so much going on,
and
so many of us are aware.
And we see in YouTube channels people with limited education or without an education, perhaps studied two or three books. Now they come on social media and propagate the message of Islam as if they are the qualified
Yes. And we have to be very, very careful who we listen, who we follow, who we watch on Twitter, on Facebook, and on YouTube, and other things, because we may be misguided. And it's always good to, and not only just good, important to confirm with the scholars that you know and you can trust, and the scholars that probably studied Islam properly, always, you know, go with their guidance, with their assistance, with their direction. People nowadays, like, we just have everything open and we just, like, keep on watching, and we don't know where we are going. And so therefore, it's really, really important that we confirm and check our information with the reliable scholars and the correct source, the correct scholars. So coming back to the discussion, وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنَ وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ. Between the halal and haram, there are doubtful matters. لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. Many people do not know. অনেক মানুষের কিন্তু জানা নয়, অনেক মানুষের জ্ঞানের মধ্যে এটা নয় যে doubtful, সন্দেহাতীত জিনিসগুলো কি। Then Professor, I'm saying, فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ. Whoever can stay away, refrain from shubuhat, the doubtful matters, সন্দেহাতীত যে জিনিসগুলো রয়ে গেছে, যে জিনিসগুলোর মধ্যে শাক রয়ে গেছে, শাক, এই জিনিসগুলোকে যে অ্যাভয়েড করতে পারলো, যে এগুলোতে সরে থাকতে পারলো, ফাকাদ ইস্তাবরা আলিদিনহি ওয়া আরদিহি, অ্যাজ ইফ হি প্রোটেক্টেড হিমসেলফ অ্যান্ড হি প্রোটেক্টেড হিজ দিন অ্যান্ড হি প্রোটেক্টেড হিজ আরদ, হিজ অনার, হিজ ডিগনিটি অ্যান্ড রেসপেক্ট।
এখন কেউ প্রশ্ন করতে পারে, তাহলে এইরকম কী জিনিস আছে যেগুলোর মধ্যে ডাউটফুল ম্যাটার থাকতে পারে? হোয়াট এক্সাম্পল ক্যান উই গিভ?
সো ফর এক্সাম্পল, I'll give you one example. I remember, like, I was when I was in Egypt back in the days, we were on a trip, and we had a few brothers, like, you know, together having a lot of discussions about different issues. So we were discussing about the issue of smoking. মানে আমরা ধূমপান হুকুমটা কি, এটা কি শরীয়ত, কি শরীয়ত মোতাবেক এটা জায়েজ না জায়েজ, এটা হালাল না হারাম, এটার মানে আসল ইয়েটা কি। তখন আমরা we were discussing about this specific subject. And there was a brother, he was saying, so one brother was saying it's haram. So he's taking the, and just to confirm and clear, The issue of smoking, there is a difference of opinions among the scholars. Some say it's haram based on the modern medical sort of experiments and medical research, which is obviously very harmful.
According to World Health Organization, yeah, according to NHS and other credible organization,
it's a confirmed harm, you know, for people in general.
Not only the smoker, but also the passive smoker, people around us, and the environment as well.
Yes. But there is also another valid opinion that it says it's makruh tahrimi, which means like a strongly disliked makruh.
Now, some may say that that opinion was founded when the medical science did not advance to the level that it is advanced today.
Yeah.
So perhaps the opinion might have applied at that point, but not necessarily mean it could be still be standing the same validity.
Yes. So, but then they would say they discussed it that way, that, you know, it's not mentioned clearly in Quran, Hadith, that it's haram. So there's not a clear-cut evidence. Based on that, they said, okay, if there is no clear-cut evidence to say that it's haram, like, you know, smoking is haram in Quran or Hadith, then we go for the second, which is a bit lower. It is harmful, but we take it as makruh at-tahrimi, which is, like, you know, strongly disliked. Excuse me. So, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ وَبَيْنَهُمْ أُمُورٌ. So then, yeah, going back. So the brothers were discussing, and there was one was saying haram, and the other brother saying, no, it's halal. There's no any clear-cut evidence. And he was using that hadith saying, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنْ وَالْحَرَامَ بَيِّنْ. The halal is clear and the haram is clear. Halal is clear and haram. And he doesn't say the next bit, which says, وَبَيْنَهُمْ أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ.
Okay.
That between them two, there are doubtful matters. He does not say that. But Prophet ﷺ said, وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ. So when we quote a hadith or Quran, we must quote it properly, and we must quote the hadith and Quran in context, and not just like quote half of it or partial text and then leave the rest.
So the question I would have is, when people normally associate such matters with deen and make a comment as if like they have full knowledge or authority on this subject. Now, this is where we dwell into issues. Person who's not qualified passes a comment. And unfortunately today we have got YouTube where the more likes you have, the more shares you have.
It's more about likes, and it's more about creating more followers and more shares you have. And find ways to create followers.
And unfortunately we have created a trend because it's been followed by so many people, or it's been shared by so many people, or it's been liked by so many people, so it establishes a validity.
Yeah, it's like that is the right thing.
That's correct.
But this is not what it is. The majority, like, even if the majority say something, it does not mean it's necessarily right, because sometimes majority can be wrong. And in Quran it says, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. In Quran, you know, repeatedly says bulk of mankind, or majority of the people, don't know. Majority of the people didn't follow the right, you know, the correct path.
Not necessarily.
So again, we have to quote the ahadith. Amra Quran ebong sunnake amra quote korte hobe, mention korte hobe, context er bitore, within the context. So then he said, فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْدِهِ. Whoever can avoid and stay away from the doubtful matters, he's as if he protected his deen, his religion, and he protected his honor. Like, for example, sometimes we do things that are doubtful. It can bring some sort of scar on our dignity and honor. But if we avoid those doubtful matters, like places that you shouldn't be in, right? If you're there, then it can create doubts. So it's better to stay away, if possible, unless there is a valid reason, unless there is a necessity. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, in general case, it's better to stay away from the places can be doubtful. Or like the things or time. Sometimes, like, you know, it's good to be careful and stay away, because that saves dignity and honor. As now, Prophet said.
Let me give you a practical example. Say, for example, we have seen a lot of, as an imam, I'm sure you're dealing with a lot of marital issues. Mm-hmm. Now, we understand in Islam, the opposite gender should not be secluded in an area where there's no other being is present. Mm-hmm. Now, if they happen to be seen by extended family members or family members, that can create doubt about such matters. Mm-hmm. So are you referring to these such kind of things there where people can misinterpret things? It's best to avoid.
Exactly, yes. Very, very important. And this is the reason why even Prophet ﷺ said, like, when there is a man and woman in one place alone, the third one is shaitan.
Okay.
And as I said, there are so many things in Islam, actually, it made things so that we are away from the doubtful matters, and we're nowhere near to the things that are haram.
Now, is it?
And this is the reason why Quran says, when it comes to obviously the issue of zina, it says, "Wala taqrabu zina," It doesn't say don't, Quran doesn't say don't do zina, but it says wala taqrabu zina, a relationship without outside
don't
marriage.
Come closer to
outside marriage.
Yeah.
And so Quran says don't even go close to it, like don't do things that can lead to it. And so therefore, Islam is very clear about those things. So we have to avoid the places and time and things that can create and bring and cause doubtful or some sort of like suspicion and doubts on ourselves.
But on the other side, people must say you shouldn't be suspecting, you shouldn't be doubting.
So that's right. Islam also says that we must have the good opinion on people.
Not and only that, is, does not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا.
Yeah, make of course, like verify. And good opinion meaning, مَنُشْتِرْ بَوْتِي أَمَدَ بَالُوْ دَرْنَا دَكْتَبَ شُوْ دَرْنَا دَكْتَبَ. This is the default position, yes. But unfortunately, we have people who are not all the same. We have people who are in society, those who are constantly thinking bad and negative about people,
and
discussing and gossiping about other people and trying to find faults.
Na ekhane amader durbhagyo hocche ekhane je nijer ghorer byapare kono khobor nai, cheler somporke jani na, me somporke dharona nai, kintu onnor ghore ki hocche, onnor songshare ki hocche, eta niye amra.
And this is very true. And Imam Taymiyyah rahimahullah said something very nicely, that some people have become like flies. What does it mean, fellow? Mane machir moto hoye geche onekulo amader. Because machi, the fly doesn't sit unless in a bad thing, something that is bad, stinky, like something that is disliked.
Or harmful. Yes.
Yeah. So some of us we just like, you know, we have become like flies. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said. And what is the quality of those people, or what are the attributes of those people? They're constantly finding and looking for the faults and weak sides of other people, and forgetting the good sides. And we have to be a people of thinking positively and having good opinion on people, and try and find good sides. Try and look for the good things on other people. আমাদেরকে অবশ্যই আমরা দেখতে হবে যে অন্য মানুষের ভালো গুণ কি আছে। আমরা শুধু কিন্তু খারাপ গুণের দিকে আমরা দেখতে চাই।
অসংখ্য ধন্যবাদ। আমরা আলোচনা করছিলাম আজকে doubtful, avoiding doubtful matters. And one of the things that has come up here is let us focus on things that matter to us and avoid things that is least concerning. And inshallah, we'll continue our discussion after the short break. Do stay tuned with us. We'll be right back. Wassalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back. You're watching Towards the Origin in conversation with Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman, who is one of the respected Imam and Khateeb of the famously known mosque, Regent's Park Mosque. Our tonight's discussion is on the topic dealing with doubtful matters. In our first segment, we have touched upon what Allah has mentioned, what the hadith has mentioned about what is haram and what is halal, and between them, what are the matters and what should we do. Inshallah, we'll continue our conversation in this segment and try and find out practical application of how to avoid things or keep ourselves away from matters of doubt, from matter of conflict, from matter of suspicion. And all of this, inshallah, do stay with us, tune with us, and inshallah, we'll be continuing our discussion. And this program is watched live on Channel S, Sky 777, and the repeat of this show will also be aired tomorrow at 11 o'clock. And later on, inshallah, you'll also find us on YouTube channel. To all of those who have joined through our Facebook page and website, thank you very much, and keep watching Towards the Origin. Sheikh, now, obviously, we've touched on the first segment. You've clearly mentioned about the hukum of haram and halal, and you've given practical examples of what doubtful matter can constitute. Mm-hmm. We've also touched on the angle of people who are nowadays celebrity shuyukhs, who either could be a Facebook shuyukh or a YouTube shuyukh or a mufti.
And if you have big number of views...
And views or followers, that tells you that he must be genuine or she must be genuine.
Somehow they're accepted.
Mm-hmm. And one thing before I continue with this discussion, as a layman, people who, for example, like me, who might not have a proper knowledge and understanding of who an alim is, who a mufti is, who a faqih is. Now, I might be easily carried away or influenced because Allah may have given some people with some attributes. For example, some could be very good orator, speaker.
Yes.
So they have, when you listen to them, perhaps they might have no academic qualification on this matter, but you feel an awe for them.
Very important question, really important question. I think we always, this is the reason why we have to go back to see like where this person studied. And this is the reason why we have to go back to the recognition. Like sometimes people can be scholars by studying in like unknown circles, or maybe like some scholars like privately. But generally, people who are actually like, you know, scholars, reliable scholars, they have to study under some of the most maybe recognized scholars of the world. And they have to study also in recognized Islamic institutions.
So that's...
Unless and otherwise, we have to be very careful.
Where we take our fiqh from.
Exactly, where we take our hadith from, or tafsir from, or fiqh from.
But having said that, I have to also be careful. There are some good quality, genuinely highly educated caliber people out there who might have not gone to the conventional Darul Uloom. They don't give direct fatwa, but when it comes to Islamic orator or da'wah work, they are known to be the best. So we have examples.
That's fine. I mean, everybody should speak according to their own specialization. Okay. And there's no harm in it. For example, I'm talking about things that I know. As soon as I go to a subject or a science that I think I'm not confident or I don't know, I should clearly mention that I'm not an expert. And I'll tell you an example. I'll give you some example. When you, alhamdulillah, we met some of the scholars in Al-Azhar, in Cairo, in Egypt. And believe me, it was quite surprising for us, for me especially. Like a scholar of fiqh, someone who studied for years, like maybe 20, 25 years.
Just to, for the help of viewers, fiqh means Islamic jurisprudence.
Islamic jurisprudence, like Islamic law. I asked him, for example, ustad or doctor, obviously normally they're doctors, like, you know, what do you think of this ayah or the meaning of this ayah? He said, look, this is tafsir. My specialization is fiqh. Even though I studied tafsir, but I don't want to give answer. Please go to the scholar of tafsir. Go to ustad of tafsir and speak to him. And similarly, they would say about hadith, go and speak to the ustad of hadith. This shows the honesty of knowledge. There is honesty. And we have to be honest to ourselves. And we have to learn how to say, like, you know, I'm not quite sure about this. Like, there's a tendency that, you know, we have to always say that we have to somehow give an answer. Well, this is a tendency. And our people don't excuse. Amader mane amra jidra jara luk jara asen amader samaj kintu amaderke consider kore na samaj mone kore je apni jodi alim hoye thaken tale apni shobkichu jante hobe.
That's correct.
This is not right. This is not true. Even if you go to someone who studied like normal education, he would not know everything about his own subject.
Ekhane ekta kotha ache karon, for example, even though if you're an alim, that does not necessarily qualify you to be an expert in the field of Islamic finance.
Absolutely. And in Islam, in Arabic, there's a very famous saying, لِكُلِّ فَنِّ رِجَالِ. Every art has its own artist and expert.
So thank you very much for clarifying that. Now, Mababa hishabe daitto ki tahole.
And yeah, that's very, very important. Again, so parents always should guide the children. And amader pitamata amader ki kintu amader chelemederke bolben je kothay jaben ebong chesta korben nasihat korar jonno direction dewar jonno guidance dewar jonno.
But ekhon to onek kichu shuja hoye geche amra iPad diye dicchi, tablet diye dicchi bachchaderke to use in their own bedroom.
We have to be careful. People are being misguided and there is so much going on. Now, very important what we discussed now. Coming back to the hadith again. So Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَنْ وَقَعَ فِي الشُّبُهَاتِ وَقَعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ. Whoever falls into the doubtful matters, they fall into haram. So meaning, if you keep on doing things that are doubtful all the time, then soon you'll be in haram. Okay? And then he's saying, كَالرَّاعِ, he's giving an example here, a parable. He's saying, كَالرَّاعِ يَرَعَ حَوْلَ الْحِمَى. Like a shepherd, ajun rakal. একজন রাখাল ছেলে সে তার অ্যানিমলগুলোকে তার যে গরু ছাগলগুলোকে সে লুক আফটার করতেছে হি ইজ লুকিং আফটার দ্য অ্যানিমলস এ শেপার্ড এন্ড দেন ইউশিকু আন ইয়ারতা ফি ইউশিকু আন ইয়ারতা ফি সো এন্ড অন দ্য সাইড ওয়ে হি ইজ লুকিং আফটার দ্য অ্যানিমলস দের ইজ এ প্লেস হুইচ ইজ স্যাংচুয়ারি লাইক এ প্রাইভেট প্লেস উইথ গ্রাস এন্ড এভরিথিং নাও ইফ দ্য শেপার্ড টেক দ্য অ্যানিমলস নেক্সট টু দ্য ফিল্ড হুইচ ইজ প্রোটেক্টেড ফেন্স মানে এটা প্রোটেক্টেড একটা এলাকা সুন দ্য অ্যানিমলস উইল গেট ইন টু দ্য আদার সাইড দে উইল ইউ ক্যান স্টপ দেম লাইক আপনি কি আপনার ছাগল আপনার ম্যাশ আপনার গরু আপনি লুক আফটার করতেছেন আপনার কাছে একটা কিন্তু খুবই ঘাস ঘাস ঘাসের একটা জায়গা আছে তবে প্রোটেক্টেড বেড় দেওয়া আছে ইফ ইউ টেক টু দ্য বোর্ডার দ্য অ্যানিমলস উইল গো অ্যান্ড জাম্প ইন টু দ্য আদার সাইড ওরা কিন্তু ওই দিকে চলে যাবে সো প্রফেসর আম সেইং Similarly, Allah wa inna li kulli malikin hima. Every master, king, and president, and prime minister has a sanctuary, like a special place that not everyone can go in. And saying, Allah wa inna hima Allahi maharimu. And the sanctuary of Allah, man Allah is special, the jagat shara wa haram. And nobody should come near to it. Maharimu. And then he's saying, Allah wa inna fil jasadi mudgha, beware, shuno, listen, that in human body there is a piece of flesh. وَإِنْ أَلَأْ وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةٍ إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ If that piece of flesh is sound, healthy, the whole entire body is sound and healthy. And if that piece of flesh is corrupt and bad and unhealthy, the whole entire body is unhealthy. And then he's saying, this is none other, nothing and none other than the heart, ala wa hiya al-qalb. So Prophet ﷺ saying again towards the end about the qalb, again inward side, the internal side. Some of us, many of us, we only focus on the external things. External things are important, of course, but engine, like in a car vehicle, engine, you can't see it. However, it's the most important thing, part in a vehicle. Engine is very important. Similarly, heart is very, very important. And Quran says very clearly, do not come to Yawm al-Qiyamah on the Day of Judgment unless there is a sound and good heart. So this is the end of hadith, and it's talking about that we need to stay away from things that are doubtful. So, for example, we enter into supermarkets like Asda, Sainsbury's, like obviously big supermarkets, and I don't want to name, but then we find products that are clearly halal, that we know, and it says halal as well, the certified halal. But then there are things that we may not know, we're not sure about the ingredients, so it's better to check our information. Because, of course, we don't want to fall into the doubtful things. And similarly, I have seen, and I must mention this, I've seen actually people are coming to restaurants. I'll give you an example. I don't want to mention the name of the restaurant. I saw a restaurant where people come every single day, Muslim people are practicing, people are coming and eating. One day I decided to go into that restaurant, and I know a brother who works there. He's a Muslim brother. And I asked, like, you know, brother, and he knows me as well, so like, is your food halal? I mean, is the stuff that you sell is halal? He said, brother, I wouldn't advise you to have anything apart from fish. And I see people are coming every single day and eating food there. Because it says, just because it says halal on the door.
But again, some may say, that's my responsibility. Because it says on the door, I've asked, it says halal, so yeah. What's my responsibility?
Yeah, that is true. But again, if we are going to eat somewhere regularly, it's good to do a bit of research.
I mean, I think what you're trying to say...
I know it's difficult, but we need to try our best.
So I think what you're trying to say is, say, for example, when we are planning to buy a house, mm-hmm. do we just see a house and buy it, or do we do a research?
Exactly.
Do we do a study?
We need to be careful. It's not like anything and everything. I know it's difficult because it's not always easy, but again, still, we need to have that realization. We have to have this... Before we eat, we have to be careful what we are giving
and where we are eating. And perhaps cross-check and do your due diligence to make sure
exactly
that everything what has been said matches up.
Now, coming to, again, like eating what you're eating, are you eating the property of your, like your own belonging, your own thing, or you're eating the property or eating the belonging of other people? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once he was walking on the street, look at the wara and taqwa and the piety and the God consciousness of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was walking on the street and he found a date. Uni rastar moddhe hatte chilen ekta khajur peyechen, khajur choto moto ekta khajur peyechen on the street. Then he said, he took it and then he said, laula anni akhafu an takuna min as-sadaqa. He said, if I didn't think that this is a charity date, charity, it's not like a, you know, it's part of the charity or maybe belongs to the charity, min as-sadaqa la akaltuha. He said, I would have eaten, but I think it's maybe it belongs to a charity, public people. I don't want to eat.
So what do you do with that?
Can you see a date? So of course, like you check and you find and you look for the opportunity, like you look for the right person, and if not, then give it to charity itself.
Okay. But do not keep it to yourself.
Yeah, do not keep it to yourself. Do not eat, because that's part of taqwa. Again, here we're talking about the wara. We are talking about things that sometimes can be allowed, but we're still by, you know, we're trying to be careful. This is what we're doing. So again, this is a very important hadith. Then I would like to mention another hadith of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sorry, actually, this is about Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. And that's dealing with the public money. And subhanAllah, many of us, we're not careful. And I say normally, dealing with public fund is like dealing with fire. What do I mean?
So when you say public money, you're talking about people who are in charge or responsible of either Baitul Mal or finance in terms
of... And maybe people. You are responsible. You've been given some sort of responsibility to deal with public fund.
Or ministerial portfolio, I think, along which they've got the responsibility to look after the country's
finance. It could be like, for example, in a business that you have some sort of limit to spend money.
Okay.
And you need to be careful what you're spending, even though the managers and the boss gave you the authorization. Mm. But you still need to be careful how you are spending, because you are, again, being watched by Allah. Inna rabbaka la bil mirsad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever watchful, in Quran al-Karim it says. Uni shoda, shorboda, uni amadirke, kintu watch kortesen, dektesen amadirke. So this hadith, Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu,
right, he used to give benefits. We think like benefits is just a new thing. But actually, Khulafa al-Rashideen, the rightly guided caliphs, we're not looking to benefit them.
Social welfare system.
Allowance, okay. Yes.
Exactly. So Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu, kana farada lil muhajirin al-awwalin 4,000.
অর্থাৎ উমর ইবনে খাত্তাব রাদিয়াল্লাহু আনহু যারা মুহাজির যারা ছিলেন মক্কা মুকাররমা থেকে প্রথম সারির মুহাজির যারা ছিলেন হু এট দ্য বিগিনিং মাইগ্রেটেড ফ্রম মক্কা আল মুকাররমা টু মদিনা আল মুনাওয়ারা হি অ্যালোকেটেড 4,000 ফর দেম অ্যাজ অ্যালাউন্স ওকে 4,000
নাও বাট ফর হিজ সান হোয়াট হি ডিড লিবনিহি 3,500 ফর হিজ সান হি অনলি অ্যালোকেটেড 3,500
ইজ ইট দ্য ক্যাশ কারেন্সি
ইয়েস maybe dinar and
or something equivalent to that amount.
Yes. Okay. And he reduced the money for his son. Okay, so now the Muhajirun sahaba asking, you are reducing for your own son. Why less for him? They're questioning
of the Khalifa.
Yeah, why are you giving him less? Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu is saying, innama hajara bihi abu.
The reason why I'm giving him less because he is not the one who came. He wasn't the main muhajir, migrant. It is his father.
He accompanied his father.
Mm. He came with his father. So unar babar shathe uni eshechilen. Unar baba Umar ibn Khattab unar nijer kotha boltesen. Ami eshechilam ebong amar shathe uni eshechen. So he came with me. So he wasn't the actual migrant. And so this is the reason I'm giving him less. Subhanallah. Taqwa.
Subhanallah.
When it comes to the public fund and avoiding the doubtful matters. And so today you see like in many parts of the world, that what we do as soon as we are people of power, authority,
especially the Muslim umara and zama,
we fill our pockets. Many of us, unfortunately, I mean, in many parts, and unfortunately, there's a lot of fasad, corruption, fasad mali, financial corruption we see in many parts of the world, and this is very unfortunate. And so you see the prosperity. Why there's no justice today? Wallahi, there is lack of justice and fairness in this world. And I can feel, I mean, dekhte pachhi amader samajer moddhe bortoman je shomoye, there is so much injustice and so much dhulum and unfairness going on. And the dhulum is not only just on physical level, but also on financial level, there's dhulum. And so Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, that's his taqwa, that's his avoiding doubtful matters, and he is giving his son less. And we know there are many other stories like that.
And now just to clarify, he's giving his son less. Some people may misinterpret things because it's all about fairness.
Again, yes.
Yeah, so it doesn't mean that if his son was eligible to get equivalent to the same amount that is given to the other people who have done hijrah, then he would have been entitled to get the same amount. But this, the conversation is, it's all about qist, it's all about giving fairness and with balance and appropriation.
Exactly, middle path and also fairness, insaf, very important.
That doesn't mean we take away the right of others just because he's my son or my daughter,
rather
keep it balanced so that everyone's equal in the sight of Allah.
Absolutely correct. That's it, yes. So that's how our Sahaba radiallahu anhum and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dealt with the things. And so it is a reminder for myself and to whoever deal with the public money or public fund or maybe charity, they're responsible for charity organizations, we need to be careful how we deal with the money of people.
Now, good thing is you mentioned about charity. A lot of people have doubts in their mind. We're not saying that all charities have got issues or anything, but a lot of people have concerns about charity organization. Now, there are two elements to it. First, just merely having a doubt about organization without any evidence, because
that's
one organization
wrong.
Yeah. And the other side of it, charity in the name of fundraising, a lot of time we do hear a lot of stories that unfortunately it goes against the sunnah or the tradition. How do we balance?
That's right. Yeah, that's right. And so as I said, again, before we do this job, we have to also study. We have to learn like how to do these things, because sadaqah is a big important part of Islam. And in hadith, in Quran, in many Islamic books, you'll find Babu Sadaqah, the chapter of sadaqah, a charity. So we have to learn how to do these things. And not anybody and everybody can also be allocated and do. So, I mean, there's knowledge with regards to also sadaqah and collection of sadaqah. And also, we must try our best to remain with what we say. Like a lot of time we say something and we do something else. So, and we kind of find ways to make it like allowed. We say, okay, you know, I know it's difficult, not always it's easy, but we have to try our best, meaning there has to be a taqwa, meaning we have to also fear Allah that I will be questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about this amount or about that pound. not only just like a pound, maybe
a penny.
Okay. Of course, and that needs to be, again, like we have to be careful, because as I said, we are dealing with fire and snake, we're dealing with fire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question about this very, very strongly. So again, I would like to say a beautiful like a statement of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to the doubtful matter. Aisha radiallahu anha, she is saying that her father, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he had a ghulam, he had a servant, meaning he used to work. And this servant used to sometimes make money and make income. And he used to bring to give it to say Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So then one day, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he is eating from something that the boy gave him. So then he said, فَأَكَلَ مِنْهُ أَبُو بَكْرَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ فَقَالَ لَهُ الْغُلَامُ تَدْرِي مَا هَذَا وَيْ چَلَتَ بَلْچَ تَرْبُرَي وَنِي كَوَرْ بُرَي بَلْچَ Do you know what you are eating? أَبْنِكِ جَانَنَا أَبْنِكِ كَاتْسَن So then, فَقَالَ وَمَا هُوَ أَبُو بَكْرَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ What was it then? He said, كُنْتُ تَكَهَّنْتُ لِلْإِنسَانِ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ He said, I used to be an astrologer. Meaning I used to do astrology in my Jahiliyyah time. What is astrology? Astrology is that you look at the sun and moon and then you see the effect of sun and moon or movements of the sun and moon on people's body. So I used to be an astrologer and I used to do astrology. And during that time, I used to make money. And actually, I wasn't an expert, but I used to deceive people. I used to pretend like I knew. And so I used to make money. And I got some money from that time someone gave me and I bought something and you were eating from that. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu instantly, he put his hand, inserted his hand and he deliberately vomited what he had.
Okay.
Because he had something that is doubtful. So we have to be very, very careful in general. And again, we have to also avoid at the same time suspicion and doubts and remain again within the obviously like the teaching of Allah and Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Jazakallah khair. Our time is up. Inshallah, we'd love to continue, but inshallah, in our next episode, we'll perhaps discuss something new in the new version. Inshallah. With this, my dear viewers, we have come to the conclusion of our tonight's discussion. We have been discussing avoiding or dealings with doubtful matters. One of the fundamental principles that we can learn from our today's discussion is we should always remain steadfast and ask those who are qualified in the matter of expert field. And perhaps take their knowledge and understanding and make a decision. And if you're not sure, do consult or let us consult qualified scholars or people who are expert in the respective fields before we make a decision. And finally, if we do have any doubt, if we're not sure, as the Sheikh has mentioned in his conversation, let us avoid it. Let us keep ourselves in distance if we're in doubtful and only consider or take this into account those that are lawful and those are permissible for us to inshallah use and utilize. That's all for us from here for tonight. Inshallah, until we meet next time. Subhanaka Allahumma wa hamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Thank you very much.
Allah ybarik fikum. Jazakumullah khairan.